Next is the adoption of the agenda. And we have minutes of the previous meeting. Okay, all right. We'll forgo the minutes. All right, thank you. Well, we're very pleased tonight to have in our audience members of the city staff and the different commissions. And we thank you very, very much for coming and spending your time with us. We will use this opportunity that you've given us to take a look at the things that you have to say about what you think the charter will look like, your opinions. Your opinions count to us. We want information not only from you as staff members and as commission members, but also from the general public as well. So we want to get a round view of how the citizens of Flint would like to see this charter revised, and if it's revised, but how it will look when we have completed our task. And so we thank you again for joining us, and we look forward to questioning you regarding your comments and so forth. So thank you very much again. So our special presentations to the commission by city officials and staff. And our first is Mr. Edward Parker, who is the director of the Flint Civil Service Commission. And we're asking each person to speak no more than 5 minutes, and then we will have an opportunity to ask questions also with a 5 minute period. I would also ask Janelle to, for the record, that Commissioner Cherry has arrived.
Thank you. Thank you.
Hey, how you doing, Spot? Good, you're looking great.
My name is Edward Parker. I'm the Director of the Civil Service Commission. I am referring to the two-page handout that I gave you. This will outline what you want, the charter mandates on the present charter for the Flint Civil Service Commission.
Okay. I'll save my. If you have any questions, I'm available. My phone number's on the bottom of the sheet. I will say this, the Flint Civil Service Commission is a charter mandated service in which is similar to a court or tribunal. It hears cases regarding employee complaints as to the City of Flint and Hurley Medical Center. It operates on what's called the merit principle, which is a fairness doctrine in all employment practices. There are seven commissioners. The charter spells out how they're appointed. We conduct public hearings, and occasionally our cases are taken on appeal. The commission is staffed by a director and support people. There's a written record. There's a mandate that the commission be funded by the council and by the city. It is exclusive remedy. This is important. It is exclusive remedy for what's called exempt employees at Hurley and City of Flint. The only due process hearing route that they have short of a court, if they don't have a collective bargaining agreement, is through the Flint Civil Service Commission. The commission operated from the 1970s, when the commission was mandated by the charter, and was until December of 2011. There have been three directors over this 35-year period. Myself, Tony Marola, who was former director of human resources for the City of Flint, and the Honorable Tracy Collier-Nix. And in December of 2011, Michael Brown, the emergency financial manager, discharged myself, staff member, and eliminated the commission. At the time the commission was, the doors were closed, there were 22 pending cases that were unresolved, people that had filed complaints that didn't get their hearings. Honestly, I have no idea what happened to those cases. Hopefully the union took them on and litigated them, but I have no knowledge. On November the 4th, last year, 71% of the electorate voted that the Flint Civil Service Commission should not be eliminated. On April the 21st, 2015, the departing emergency financial manager ordered that there be no funding for the Flint Civil Service Commission. I'm here today as a volunteer. I haven't been paid for 3.5 years. The commission still exists, and I urge you folks to do something in the charter with it, because folks that voted don't want it eliminated. So it becomes your task to determine what is the best way to deliver this service to the employees of Hurley Medical Center and the city of Flint. I have a lot of ideas, so do the former commissioners. I assume there'll be at some point in time, there'll be an opportunity where they can give you input on their thoughts on the commission. I doubt it could ever be done in 5 minutes. That's the fastest I've ever given a closing statement or an opening statement. Questions?
Thank you, Mr. Park. Questions?
Yes, one question, Barry William. You have some ideas on how to put some teeth into always having that position open and funded. Do you have any ideas on that?
Well,
you don't have to tell them now.
There isn't a problem with the charter. The teeth are there. It's the fact that no one chose to litigate this against the state of Michigan, the financial manager, and the city of Flint. The funds didn't exist for the attorney fees, et cetera. And short of a court order mandating services, mandating a budget, maybe not. We would hope that the people would honor your view of what the charter should look like as far as the Civil Service Commission or all the other parts of the new charter.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Richardson?
Yes, sir.
I'm curious. How many employees within the city and in Hurley are not represented by a union?
I have no idea. At one time, I heard the number, like in Flint, was maybe, city of Flint was maybe 80 or 90. It's all the folks that are in what's called exempt positions. They possibly work for a head administrator, or they work in the personnel department, or they work in the Civil Service Commission. There are a number of folks, but the city would have to supply you with that information, as would Hurley. I think Hurley has quite a few exempts.
So the Civil Service Commission, who do you hear, what employees come to you for some sort of remediation?
It can be any employee in the civil service, which is the group of people that work for the city as a civil service, other than the ombudsman, civil service director, city attorney. There are, in the charter, it lays out some folks that are not able to use the service.
So what would the Civil Service Commission do differently than what a union would do?
In the charter, the employee is given an opportunity to either to use their collective bargaining agreement, grievance procedure, or they can use the civil service.
Can they use both?
No, it's excluded. Once you make an election, that's it. However, I have to kind of tell you there's an exception. Some unions do not have any language in their contract about the use of the Civil Service Commission. And now it's been 4 years. I used to be right up on top of this stuff. Everybody that could use it, everybody that couldn't use it, but I can't tell you now because of the right to work law. New collective bargaining agreements have been entered into between employee groups. Hurley has far more unions than the city of Flint. And so each collective bargaining agreement would have to be reviewed to determine whether or not there was a right to use a civil service commission in that collective bargaining agreement.
If an employee disagreed with the civil service commission's ruling, could they go to court?
Yes, sir.
So anything, any of the issues could also go to one of the courts as well?
Well, when the court reviews it, it's not a brand new hearing. It's not all the testimony and new witnesses. The court looks to see if the commission, if the commission itself, the tribunal, the seven commissioners, if their determination was contrary to law. And the court reviews that and determines whether or not that occurred. It can uphold that decision or it can overturn it.
I'm trying to understand how what the Civil Service Commission does, whether it's duplicative of what a union would do and what a court would do. That's what I'm trying to understand.
Well, first thing is, it's not duplicate of a court. A court, well, I guess a person could file a lawsuit, you know, over their employment problem. I think that could be, I think one of the reasons it was in the charter is you sure avoid a lot of attorney fees by going through this tribunal. When you go to court, jury fees, attorney fees, this is more like an arbitration. And people that have a union, depending on their collective bargaining agreement, could use either process, but not both.
Any other questions? Yes. Having been a former employee of the city of Flint and having used the Civil Service Commission, I would like to see the Civil Service Commission included in the charter. Sometimes people do have problems on their jobs within the city, and they talk with their union reps. Union reps can't seem to solve that problem just in a verbal discussion. And so that person will decide to go to the Civil Service Commission rather than using union representation. And so I applaud this commission, the Civil Service Commission. I hope that it is kept in the charter. It's a viable tool for the employees, not only of the city, but of the hospital. Having a former parent that was an employee of the hospital, Hurley Hospital, she had to use the Civil Service Commission on her job. And so I appreciate the work of the Civil Service Commission. I hope and pray that we do have this put back into the charter.
Oh, it's still in the charter.
Well, I know it's still there, but there are some people that don't want it.
Right, of course.
Thank you.
Mr. Parker, thank you so very much. And
thank you.
We do plan to have future meetings. Oh, okay. We do plan to have future meetings. And for those of the commission who would like to speak before the commission, we will have more opportunities for that, as well as you're very welcome to also submit it in writing, any suggestions you may have or comments.
Thank you.
Mr. Cherry.
A couple of questions, please. Does the Civil Service Commission still operate right now?
No.
So the commission, there are no commissioners currently appointed?
There are actually two that still are within a term.
Okay.
It's the process is laid out in the charter, but basically the terms expire at different times, so you don't loop, everybody isn't off at the same moment. And so we still have two people that are holding a position. Barbara
okay.
Wesley, who is the chairperson, who is what's called a public at large, she's appointed by the four commissioners, one elected by Hurley employees, one elected by the city employees, one appointed by the administration of the city, and one appointed by the administration of Hurley, have picked three other people. And there are two people left on the commission that are still within their term.
Okay. And when you were the director of the Civil Service Commission, How did you interact with the HR departments within Hurley and within the city? What kind of relationship did you have? What way did you coordinate, you know?
I wouldn't call it adversarial, but we listen to people. We decide cases where people are unhappy with what their personnel department did or their managers.
Okay.
And the relationship is cordial, but there's no reporting. There's the council, there's the mayor's office, there's the ombudsman, and there's the court down the street, the Civil Service Commission. And they're pretty well operate independently. Even though the Civil Service Commission gets its budget money from the city, it still appoints its own director, fires and hires its own staff, its own director. It's a separate tribunal.
Do our civil service commissioners reimbursed at all, or is that a volunteer position?
Totally voluntary. They have to live in the city of Flint, and certain people are elected by employees, certain people are appointed, but they're all volunteers. They come at night, 6 o'clock at night, and they listen to the cases, or at least they used to. And then they hear the cases from both sides, and then they render a decision.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
I got a question. Are the conclusions of the commission binding?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you so very much.
Thank you.
Next, we have Mr. Robert Wesley, who is the chair of the Flint Planning Commission.
Madam Chair, good evening. Needless to say, I think all of you sitting in this room and is a little chilly like I am, so I'm not going to hold you long.
Thank you.
You know, I've sat in this chamber, and I'm going to tell you, it is quite chilly. But this evening we have Ms. Elizabeth Jordan from the Planning Commission and Mr. Patrick Rouse also here this evening. But I'm going to just take a brief moment, and we're going to be presenting you something in writing formally from the Planning Commission. But the Planning Commission, which is not a department with the City of Flint, we work in relationship with Department Planning and Development Office. The Commission is established in state law. Unlike Mr. Parker, who was before us, we were established in state law. The Planning Commission, from the Enabling Act of PA 33 of 2008, established the certain roles and duties of the Planning Commission. The Commission, the commissioners, is appointed by the Chief Executive Officer, which is the mayor, and is usually the council person that recommends a commissioner to the mayor, and the mayor makes the appointment. The Planning Commission is mostly five. Commissioners are 5, 7, 9, or 11 members. Right now, of 3-year terms, we have 9, and they're represented in geographical as wards. Each commissioner represents a ward, 1st, 2nd, 3rd, 4th, 5th, 6th, 7th, and 8th, and 9th wards from the City of Flint. The local body can add, members shall be represented, like I said, of different wards, and we try to look at each member's for the community as such, like education, public health, transportation, that represents all of these things geographically all around. Okay. It says, under state law, the city may hire a chief planning officer and a planning staff. Flint current charter requires a chief planning officer. Our experience is that such staff support is required to do the work required under the state law, especially around the master planning process and the 5-year updates, you know. And we look at a master plan, And we were fortunate this year. We've had our first master plan in 50-odd years in the city of Flint. And when we look at that master plan, it's a projection 20 years out in the foreseeable future. That's how our master plan is put together. Under state law, the Planning Commission, on a two-thirds majority vote, approves the master plan is the final step. Now, the charter says, and that's what the charter can do, the charter says that we do the master plan, we approve it, we send it on to council. Council has the final approval of the master plan. They can make adjustments, additions, and then it is adopted. And this year, for the first time, we had a master plan, and like I said, in 50 years, that was approved by the council unanimously, which is almost unheard of, that the council will do something, unanimously approve something of that nature. Besides the master plan, the Planning Enabling Act requires the Planning Commission to develop a capital improvement plan, which covers 7 years to be updated annually. The Planning Commission also creates and approves sub-plans such as neighborhood plans. They're working on, you know, like choice neighborhoods now. We're working on the capital improvement plan, we're working on the zoning. We're doing all of those things at this point. And that's basically, you know, what we do. I think Mr. Riles is going to touch base on some of the things, other things that the Planning Commission might do as far as training and what have you. But that's what we are established by law that we exist. Okay. And like I said before, earlier, we will be presenting you something in writing formally in the very near future. Okay. So I'll address any questions. Yes.
Mr. Wesley, you said that that state law establishes the existence of the Planning Commission.
Correct.
Does state law determine how commissioners are appointed, or is that the prerogative of the local municipality?
State law says that the commission, they have to have commissioners. How they are appointed by geographical area, with the state law, when I said geographical, they can do it one or two ways, unless otherwise specified. And that's why we have in the charter how we want commissioners to be appointed. But so the state law, they just say you must have it.
So the state law doesn't require a particular procedure. That could be determined by the local unit of government.
That is correct.
Okay. Is that, and that must also be true for the chief planning officer? You said that the state required that we have a chief planning officer.
Yes, the city may hire a chief planning officer.
May.
Mm-hmm.
Isn't required to, but may.
Well, the charter will.
I know. I'm talking about state law.
Okay, the state law says it may hire a chief planning officer and a planning staff.
Yeah, I'm just trying to determine what state law requires us to do and what we got latitude to do. Okay, thanks.
Okay. Any other questions?
Ms. Bennett, did you have a question?
I did. Actually, I thought that the state law, and this is really a clarifying question, said that unless otherwise stated in charter, that there were certain roles that you had to have professionals who had certain expertise. One was an architect. I don't have the state law in front of me, but there are certain, so the state law says have these people with these certain qualifications, or have in your charter how you would like the representation to be determined on your planning commission. And because our planning commission in our city charter says by ward, that is in fact how we are. I'm sorry. So it's really just a clarifying question that if, and it looks like Elizabeth has.
Yeah, you want to, okay. Yes.
Hi, Elizabeth Jordan, Vice Chair of the Planning Commission. Happen to have a copy of the Planning Enabling Act with me in case it came in handy. And so your question in terms of what does the state law require of the members for the Planning Commission. Part of it reads, this is section 125-3815, under number three there. It says the membership of a Planning Commission shall be representative of important segments of the community, such as the economic, governmental, educational, and social development of the local unit of government, in accordance with the major interests of, as they exist in the local unit of government, such as agriculture, natural resources, recreation, education, public health, government, transportation, industry, and commerce. The membership shall also be representative of the entire territory of the local unit of government to the extent practicable. And so it doesn't specify in the state law that it has to be by ward. That is a decision that the local municipality can decide to put into their charter or not. And then there's other parameters in terms of, as Mr. Wesley was saying, that it does state that it's got to be an appointment by the chief elected officer, and it's got to be confirmed by the legislative body. It also states, for instance, that it has to be 5, 7, 9, or 11 members. It can't be 8, it can't be 14. It's got to be one of those numbers.
I think also her question was regarding the appointment of staff, the qualifications. Mm-hmm. Isn't that true?
The state law, in my non-lawyerly reading of it, does not speak to qualifications of staff. It doesn't say that you must hire a chief planning officer. The current Flint charter does, but it merely says in the state law, on my non-lawyerly reading, that you may hire a chief planning officer and staff.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks, Lily.
Question.
Mr. Chair.
Yeah. And I'm going to ask any planning commissioner who speaks this question. Why do you think, from your perspective, why do you think it took 50 years for us to get a new master plan?
I really don't know. I think it was money. I think it was one of the things that was on the back burner. And that's one of the things, the staffing. Lack of staff to put this, you know, the master plan was a grave undertaking, and we were quite fortunate when we got a chief planner because we didn't have one for a number of years because of funds. And we was fortunate enough to get a HUD grant, $1.6 million, to put this on. And that was and we needed staff, and we had the staff, we got the staffing, and we was able to do that. And, you know, the master plan that we now have is being recognized throughout the country because we did some things that was really unique in that for as far as community engagement was concerned. And that's one of the primary things that we pride ourselves on with the Planning Commission as far as community engagement.
Do you think there was a flaw in the charter that contributed to that, or is there something that we need to look at from a charter perspective to prevent something like that happening in the future?
I don't know if it was a flaw in the charter. I think the charter was very clear. It was just the enforcement of that.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Why don't we ask Mr. Rawls to come up? There may be other questions that either one of you may be able to ask. So why don't you come on up, Mr. Rawls, this time?
My name is Patrick Rouse. I represent the second ward. And the information they got, we try not to be redundant and duplicate. And a lot of them, like I said, were a little nervous about coming. But this is the handbook that they give us. And it's always updated, okay? We meet 52 times a year. They meet the second and the fourth Tuesday of every month, okay? Unless there's no transactions or business to come before us, the chairman has the option to cancel the meeting, okay? Then we go to various trainings. Once you get on a commission and go through this book, which has everything that he he has down there and everything like that. It's very extensive. You have to learn all the ordinances, all the zoning criteria and everything like that. We go to these trainings. Now, we got partners with the city, like rural engineering and stuff, and we go to off-sites for training and stuff, and they give us a whole lot of training. So the people on the commission are highly trained, highly intelligent, and dutiful about representing their geographical area, okay? Right now, the key term is we have a working, living master plan. The last one we had in the 1965, whatever, it sat on the books. I got a copy of it. We all have a copy of it. It just sat there. They just said, we'll do this, we'll get the funding, and we'll acquiesce the citizenry, and then we just let it sit. This one is working, living, because we had total commitment and involvement from the populace. When people come to our meetings, they have copies of drafts of things that are still floating around out there to present to us because they are knowledgeable about what's going on in Flint, the community, and the neighborhood. As you mentioned, and Liz mentioned, the seven different areas of implementation that we are working on, between transportation, cultural, education, stuff like that, this is all part of the master plan. We also do ordinances and zones. We're working on the zoning criteria, trying to make it simplified so that you as citizens can understand what's going on. A1, A2, D3, FG, you don't know what that means. We're trying to make it applicable so that you know what it means. Like we say GN, that's a green neighborhood. Or MR2, which means a mixed residential neighborhood, okay? We're trying to do these things. But in doing this, and we used to have an attorney assigned to the Planning Commission. With budget cuts, we lost that ability because we tried to do things correctly. We tried not to make any mistakes. We used to have one dedicated to come to our meeting when we had a problem or a discussion about some items and things we had to go on with. As you know, we're doing with the Miracle Marijuana, okay? We established criteria. We had a moratorium for a long time, hashing out, watching all the other communities, the national media and stuff, finding out what we could live with as the city of Flint. Okay, once the doors were open and we removed that moratorium, we had certain criteria that they had to meet. Then the floodgates opened up, and we got a lot of medical marijuana facilities here. Some of them are closed down because they didn't fulfill the obligations of getting licensed and holding up to the end of the bargain, okay? So we work with a lot of things at the Planning Commission. The people are dutiful, they're intelligent, they're passionate. This is not a resume-building commission. People don't sit on this and just sit on your butt. They actually function as a commission. We all do duties. We elect our chairperson and our vice chair, who are here now, and our treasurer from our group. But all of us are qualified to do any one of those positions and do anything in this group. If you question any of us commissioners, we know what's going on. We all have the same information dissipated to us at all times. We email each other. Sometimes we talk to each other. And our representative assistant, Sherry, is overwhelmed. She's overwhelmed because of staffing. And we haven't had minutes to correct in about at least 7 months to bring to our meeting. And that's your paper trail, minutes. And we've been fighting to get some staffing to help her out because she's overwhelmed with what she has to do, because she's the one that goes through the technical part of it first before it gets to us. And then we digest it and make a decision on it. And if we don't want to, we can postpone it and get some more information. We will do that. We don't make hesitant decisions, and we don't get information at the last minute. Now, I know if you've seen, and some of you people have been on the city council, when you come to the meeting, that's where your information is at. We don't do that. We're very diligent about what we do, and we would love to have you keep us in the charter because we want to keep this plan alive and keeping moving forward, and we want to do the updates, amendments. It's not in stone. It can always be adjusted. So that's all I got. If you got any questions?
Does anyone have any questions for either one of the commissioners?
Thank you. Mr. Rawls, thank you very much for that information, particularly the information about the very hard work that the members of the commission do and the amount of knowledge that you have to generate in order to be able to do a good job at that. Commend you for the hard work that you do. When a commissioner has to be replaced, the replacement happens as something like a recommendation from a council person to the mayor, and then the mayor makes an appointment.
That is correct.
How do you feel about having certain criteria for a member of the commission for appointment to that?
You mean someone being nominated from the commissioners? I mean, from the city council?
Well, criteria about certain experience or background or some other kind of criteria for a person to be appointed as a
commissioner? Oh, that's good. Now, we've had one of our former commissioners who's on it was Freeman Greer. He's an architect. He had to leave because he wanted to do some things, and it was becoming a conflict of interest for him to approve things, and then he was architect of on some of the things. And we had Kay Kelly, who was on our commission, and she was always involved in the arts and drama, as you guys know Kay Kelly. And then we had Mrs. Howell, who had to retire. She said, my time is done, I need to retire. And we have one right now who's been under the weather for a long time, so we're looking for someone to take his spot over. So having qualifications is good, but we have a wide variety. Like Liz is our wordsmith person,
and
writes all our stuff. And she's young, and she does an excellent job. Robert is our point person, and Robert gets out front and does stuff. And I can just name off. We all know each other and know each other's characteristics.
Do you think that the charter ought to have anything in it about requiring certain skill levels to be appointed a commissioner?
That's an option, but I wouldn't push that heavily, no.
How come?
Because you will acquire those skills when you get on the board, on the commission. You acquire those skills. Some of us came on, they were a little leery about it, and some had a chance to be appointed to this by their city council person. I wasn't Jackie Poplis, who's my city councilman, her first choice, but the other people said, I don't think I want to do that. So you have to have the passion to want to learn and acquire the knowledge to do that. I can talk the language now.
So it's a requirement that a person be able to learn.
Yes.
Learn that.
Yes.
One follow-up question about it. There has been one seat that's been vacant for some time on the commission now, from the first ward, I believe.
Yes, Mr. David Jackson.
Should there be some control over the length of time a commission seat remains absent?
It is in our bylaws, but we hadn't addressed it. We were trying to give, and we wanted him back. We're kind of a close-knit commission, and we're giving him a chance. He was trying. He was really trying to come back, and sometimes he would come back, and he was in bad shape, and we told him, well, you go back out again, and after a while, we've contacted him, and he said it's not happening. He's not going to make it back. But we're close. It's in our bylaws. There is issue in our bylaws, but we were kind of living with him for a while.
Under what authority can you write bylaws for your group?
Liz? Because most of the things we incorporate in the bylaws are from the state guidelines that they gave us, like how we conduct our meeting, how do we stagger our members being there, the length of time they stay on the commission, how do we do our public hearings. A lot of that is by the state guidelines, and we use that as a boilerplate to establish our bylaws.
Found it. Thanks for answering it until I could find it there. Okay, so there's a section here that says bylaws adoption, public record requirements, annual report by planning commission. A planning commission shall adopt bylaws for the transaction of business and shall keep a public record of its resolutions, transactions, findings, and determinations. So it's a requirement.
Thank you. Are there any other questions?
So first, thank you to all the commissioners for the very heavy lift you did on the master plan. That was quite a job.
Thank you too, John, for being on that committee we were on.
Before I ask the question about the what we can do to make sure we have a master plan, are there any barriers that the commission has discussed in terms of implementation of the master plan that are relevant from a charter perspective that you're aware of?
No, I can't think of any. No. Commissioners?
Okay, and I want to just be clear that we're going to be sending you something that's kind of from the commission as a whole. So when I'm speaking as Elizabeth off the top of my head, not as a representative at this moment of the whole commission. In terms of barriers to implementation as relates to the charter, the thing that occurs to me is the state law requires us to have a master plan and to update it at least every 5 years. The state law requires us to have a capital improvement plan that looks 7 years in the future and is updated annually. The state law says we may have a chief planning officer and staff. Accomplishing those tasks to comply with state law for the city of Flint, we need those positions. And so that's where I think, personally, the charter can have a say in how effective are we in complying with state law and then being able to actually execute, is by making sure we have a chief planning officer and adequate staff.
And also, I'd like to address the question you asked Chairman Wesley about why it took so long to have a master plan. We had an all-out effort from our political leader of this municipality to push for a master plan. Before, it was not there. The energy said, yeah, but now we had a, Mayor Walling wanted a master plan. He fought for a master plan. He would come to our meetings. He wanted this to go. Then we had people that, and we're losing our master planner, which we had a little party for this week, but yes, it was nice, but she was there for us. She took the blows. It was serious business. We had a real planner. She had a passion, but she just didn't have the credentials. She worked with us on this. And we had, like I said, community engagement was number one. I know you guys probably went to some of them, probably served on some of them committees that we had. This was serious business.
Okay. So it's just the political will to get it done?
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
I have a question.
Oh, sorry, Becky.
Yes. There are some citizens that are concerned about when the master plan is fully implemented, that the city is going to be divided in half. Can you speak to that?
No. If you look at the master plan and how we got this broke down, they're worrying about what we're working on now is the zoning ordinances. Okay, the master plan will not divide anybody. It's the zone, we're reviewing all of the zoning ordinances. We got a draft about this thick. And I got some of this is the little cheat sheet right here that gets right to the heart of things. What's qualified in an area, what criteria you can have, certain things in certain areas, what areas are going to be green, a district, you got downtown quarter, you got college quarter, you got all these different quarters. We're not going to divide the city in half. That's not going to happen. But there's always someone out there that wants to deviate and add something. That's a special case that we always address, special cases. We have some people like special regulated uses. They come in and try to get something on and say, well, I want to do this over here. I want to have goats and chickens over here. I want to have housing over here, and I want to have bed and breakfast and all sorts of stuff. We have to address all those issues. Okay, when we address those issues, and some of them, there are some unique situations, like the one we had with the bed and breakfast. They wanted to set up a bed and breakfast, and they had state guidelines, and they got city guidelines, stuff like that. But we have to be aware of these guidelines and criteria. But the city will not be split in half. That's not on the Planning Commission. Now, if there's politics involved, I can't say. But as far as the Planning Commission, no. Am I right, Chairman Wesley?
Yes.
Yeah. And you know politics comes into play now. We can only do so much.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay.
All right. I know. Notice that one of your members was here. Was Reverend planning to speak? Was he planning? Okay. All right. Thank you very much. All right. Next, we have Mr. Bob Case. Mr. Case is the supervisor for the Water Pollution Control Division.
Well, good evening. Thanks for the opportunity to speak a little bit about water pollution control and the utilities department in general. Before I get started with that, though, I'd just like to give my appreciation to Mr. Parker and his presentation on the Civil Service Commission, because without them, I wouldn't be standing here this evening. I've worked for the city for 19 years, and in the role of water pollution control supervisor, and that means I run the sewage treatment plant for this is the major job I have. But there's a little more to our function than just that. I can't speak a lot to the legalities of the utilities department versus the city charter, but I can talk a little bit about operationally what we do and the importance of it to the city. The utilities department furnishes water and treats the sewage. We basically have four divisions. We have the water plant, the wastewater treatment plant. We have the water service center has two divisions, one of which takes care of the water distribution system, the other of which takes care of the sewers. So we have the collection system and the distribution system. When you put all these things together, they are the most valuable assets the city owns. They're also the most expensive to operate, but as we all know, they are essential to the public health and well-being. The charter does obligate the city to provide water service and gives it an exclusive franchise over it, and the same with the sewage treatment as well. So to do that, there's many ordinances involved, but all of that stems from the charter's authorization of the utilities department as an enterprise within the city. That means that financially and in other ways, it's supposed to be independent of the rest of the city operations. The utilities are funded by water and sewer rates, and those rates depend on what the cost of providing the service is. That's the basic concept. Operationally, the water pollution control deals not just with operating the treatment plant itself, but also pumping stations, and we also have to regulate industrial users to make sure that they don't send us any bad stuff that would interfere with the treatment system. So we have a industrial pretreatment plan staff that takes care of that. And that's about it in a nutshell. Any questions?
Is there any state law that is in place that requires a municipality to have a utilities department?
That's not really my area of expertise. Okay. I wouldn't want to
don't know.
Answer that question as such, but what I will say is state law does require the city to do a number of things, both in controlling its stormwater and its sanitary sewage. So one way or another, it has to see to it that the job gets done. And by the same token, if we provide water, there's many state regulations right. and laws dealing with how you go about that.
It's an area of the charter I haven't read a lot in yet, but I'm going to be curious to do it. Thank you.
Yeah,
you're welcome.
Go ahead.
I just had a short question. Some residents of the city have, that I know of personally, have had water lines to break, or their basements become flooded. When they contact the water department, they're told that the pipes are not city on city property. Can you speak to that to explain why?
Yes. The city operates a sewage collection system to receive all the sewage. But to get the sewage from a building to the city's sewer pipe has to go through a building lead, and that belongs to the property owner. So, and that pipe typically much smaller than the city sewer, maybe a 3 or 4 inch, 5 inch perhaps. If it's an industrial facility, it'd be a larger pipe. But that pipe is owned by the property owner. Therefore, if it gets clogged or if tree roots grow in it and block the pipe, that's the homeowner's responsibility.
So there is nothing that the water department can do to help in the cost of that homeowner to replace those pipes. I understand it's very expensive, over $5,000, that they can help to, for that homeowner to help them to replace those pipes so they can keep receiving the water from the city, which will enable the city to receive revenue. There are a lot of homes in Flint that where the property owners have not been able to replace those pipes. Thus, we have a lot of vacant homes because the homeowners have walked away. Is there any way that the city can help those homeowners in that particular cost?
Well, it is possible to buy private insurance to insure your building lead so that if you do have a problem, the insurance will cover it. But as far as the city covering the cost of that, I think the cost would be prohibitive. The city really has its hands full in dealing with its own pipes right now. Because our infrastructure is old. A lot of it dates from approaching 100 years old. And as pipes get old, they break, tree roots grow into them. That happens with the city's sewer pipes as well as those of the homeowners. And the city has to spend a lot of money just to maintain its own pipes.
Thank you.
And unfortunately, any cost, any additional cost the city were to undertake, they would have to pass that along to the citizens in the form of a rate increase. And as we all know, there's nobody likes to see rate increases, but basically, the citizens get what they pay for. If they want more services, it's going to cost them more money because we were funded only from water rates. It's the only way we can do what we do.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Cherry.
Sir? The planning commissioners had talked about capital improvement plans, and very briefly, the sewer expenses for capital infrastructure, have those regularly been part of capital improvement plans over the past 10, 20 years?
No. Generally, no. Now, the city has two types of sewers. They have storm sewers, which allow drainage from the streets to go into the rivers. And we have sanitary sewers, which bring sewage from buildings to the sewage treatment plant to be treated before it's discharged into the river. Funding the storm sewers is still a problematic area, but that's something that, because sewers are sewers, are done together with the sanitaries. But in the capital improvements area, the utilities departments, the four divisions, each have their own capital improvement budget. So each area, we look at what needs to be rehabilitated, replaced, or updated, and we fund it out of our own capital budget. But again, that cost is passed on to the ratepayers.
Consumer Powers in the Cook community has gone in and completely redone all of their pipes at no cost to the homeowners. How are they able to do this? And the city is putting that directly on the citizens. You know, that's just like the water, we pay for gas from Consumer Powers, but they make sure that their pipes are working and their meters are working. And the city says their job stops at the sidewalk. Why is that?
Well, it's because the, again, this is getting into some of the legalities that might be a little beyond my pay grade, but as I understand it, the pipes, the building leads are on the property, on private property, so the city doesn't have a right-of-way. They don't even have legal access to those pipes. But beyond that, it's a matter of law that those pipes are not included. Well, were they to be, as I say, it would be an enormous additional cost to the utility system.
Well, consumer pipes are on private property too, but they still come in and replace them.
Yeah, they do have the right of access to it, but my understanding, and again, I'm not an attorney, so I can't really speak to that authoritatively.
I just have one quick question, and that is, the trees that grow right there, is that city property or is that private property? Curb to sidewalk.
In the parkway?
No, a regular street. You own directly. You got the curb, and then you got the sidewalk, and the tree grows in between that.
Right.
Who's responsible for that property? Isn't that still the city, from the curb to the sidewalk?
My understanding is that's the city's, generally speaking, the city's responsibility. For example, the tree goes down, the city can replace that tree.
Okay, at the same time, if the roots grow into the pipes, that's going to be city's responsibility, or is that going to be the residents?
It would depend on whether the roots were growing into the building lead. That's the homeowner's responsibility, or the city's sewer pipe, that larger pipe that in the street. Both of those pipes have problems from tree roots.
Okay. All right. I'm just trying to find out, but what end, where do you divide it off? And you're saying from the sidewalk to the house, is residence, and from the sidewalk to the street is city. But if the tree is in between there and the roots grow and it grows into the pipe, that's on the city's property. That's what I was just trying to get an understanding.
Well, actually, the building lead, that pipe that goes from the building to the city sewer, even though part of its path would go under the street, that's still the homeowner's pipe.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Case.
Could I address the question to the lawyer, please?
Yes.
I see a contradiction here. So why is one thing for the city and something else for Consumer Powers? They're both utilities.
One is private.
Thank you, lawyer.
So I'm not.
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't see him.
You know, so I'm not entirely certain as to every aspect of that the answer to your question. I think Mr. Williams is probably correct. It's that Consumers is a private corporation. If they have the funds to replace those gas lines, that's probably why. Whereas the city is in many ways limited on what it can spend, both because of the revenue that it takes in, it's limited by the Revenue Bond Act and numerous other state laws and provisions. It could also be that it has something to do with the agreement that Consumers has with private property owners. But again, it's something that I would have to look into for, if I'm being honest. In many ways, I'm speculating. But I think that Mr. Williams' answer is a good one.
I'm sorry.
No, it's fine.
All right. Thank you again, Mr. Case.
Yes. One last point. You know, even with Consumers, there is a takeoff point because the electric lines come in, are tied to the house, but where the buildings wires connect from there into the building, from that point down, that's the property owner's responsibility. So all these utilities, they have some spot where the cutoff occurs.
All right. Thank you. Okay, we will move on. I would like to thank everyone for their questions and hope everyone took good notes. Let's move on to our reports. Our first report is the Finance Committee.
Okay, I'll move through this. You have before you a summary sheet that I dropped off before you for our meeting on this past Tuesday, August the 25th. Some just bullet points I recorded there. Our event, September the 26th, Heidi was at our meeting and presented her expense report. And you'll see at the bottom of this an update from our chairperson. But it was much discussion at that meeting because we weren't sure of our funding. But that's a go-ahead for sure, and I'm glad it is. We're going to move forward on the 26th with funding for that event, our kickoff. The municipal consultant is another important high-priority position, and that's still our city administrator, Ms. Henderson, has lent support in trying to seek funding from the My Foundation to support that position. Municipal legal consultant, we're going to rely heavily on Mr. David Roth over there, and we're going to rely on the city legal department to help with our issues. The administrative assistant, now that's another story. At this time, the City of Flint Human Resource Department is unable to lend support for recruitment or contracting such an individual, which I had several questions, which I listed there in this summary, of how does that work when we solicit our own? What resources do we have of the city to obtain such? What media, you know, newspapers, professional journals, and how do we get that? And how would this person respond to us? you know, these are some of the questions that we might want to discuss in a future meeting. At any rate, we'll need some legal advice on the consultant, because I think when you get into contracts, you certainly might have a confidential statement that the person needs to sign and all of that, and we have no idea how to proceed with that. As you can see, it was a meeting that lasted about an hour. We adjourned at 6:30. I don't have listed future meetings, but it was decided tonight those meetings would take place every second and fourth Tuesday at 5:30, unless otherwise noted. That's it.
And I would like to state that with the administrative assistant, we will be in consultation with the city administration regarding this position. We are not asking for a person to be hired by the city. We are asking for a contract with a person. So we will get some clarification on that and see if we can move forward with actually bringing a person on board under contract. All right.
Madam Chair, one question, and I would like for the attorney to look at, can we have our own bank account? If by chance someone donates X amount of dollars to us, that it comes straight to us and we don't have to go through the regular procedures. I don't know if we can or cannot, but that's a question I would like to be answered.
Yeah, I can certainly look into it for you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Or even like, even if it's not our own bank account, but maybe like, they could give it to the community foundation and the community foundation could expend funds on our behalf or something.
Right. Yeah. It's just that idea. I don't want someone to give us something.
You mean that the Charter Commission have an account?
Yes. I just don't want the city to come back and say, you know, someone donates some money to it and they freeze it. Right.
I understand what you're saying. I can look into it for you.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Okay, next, and we are not going to vote tonight on these. That was something we did discuss in our training, that our reports, we would not have to vote on. Yes.
Madam Chair, we might want to go back to public comment on agenda items. I think we skipped over that.
We did. Yes, we did. I'm sorry.
We just pick it up at the last.
We will. Let's move on to the Rules Committee. We'll pick it up.
Okay.
No, I don't have any slips.
No, I don't know.
Go ahead, Commissioner.
You have before you a copy of the rules of procedure that myself, Jim Richardson, and John Cherry went over. We were the ones that were at the last meeting. We did have some questions that we wanted to bring before the body.
Turn your microphone on.
It is on.
She says it's on.
Just pull it a little closer.
Can you hear me now? Can you hear me now? At the Michigan Municipal League training, it was suggested that there was a big discussion about the Committee of the Whole. And one of the questions that was brought up at our meeting was to change the name in our document from Committee of the Whole to Work Session. That was a suggestion by the MML. And so I'm bringing that question to the body. Their suggestion was that on the days that we don't meet as a committee, as a commission, the other days be called work sessions where we'll actually look at all of the procedures of documents that's coming in to change the charter to actually do the work. And so that was a question that I'm bringing to the body. Mr. Roth has given us a document on provision summaries, and a question that I have that did not come up at a meeting but that I looked at while I was sitting here. His explanation that he's given us on conflict of interest on page 5, if I'm reading it correctly, Attorney Roth, that a conflict of interest is when a person is requires the disclosure of an officer, appointee, employee's conflict of interest with something that we're discussing. In our rules of procedure, it was explained that our conflict of interest, Rule 21 and Rule 55, in voting, was if we disagree with what the proposal is on the floor, and if we were going to vote no, we have to say we have a conflict of interest first before we vote So my question is, does the conflict of interest in the document that you gave us on page 5 adhere to what we have in this document on Rule 21 and Rule 55? Are they the same?
So I actually don't have a copy of the rules in front of me. If you could provide
Is there an extra copy? The clerk has one.
What page is it on?
In our rules of procedure,
yes.
Rule 21 is on page 10, and Rule 55 is on page 20. And then in the document that Mr. Roth gave us,
yeah, I got that
this
one,
page
yeah.
five, explains the definition of conflict of interest. And if they're not the same, according to the document that Mr. Roth gave us, then we need to change it in our rules of procedure.
While Mr. Roth is looking at that, Jim, did this incorporate any alterations associated with your communication with Mr. Roth?
Yeah. If you look at the bottom of the page, is the date on it? There's an 8/27/2015 date.
Okay.
On the bottom. Perhaps we all ought to be working from the 8/27/2015 document that was passed out this evening. Because in my copy, Rule 21 is on page 8. So you gotta look at the very bottom of the page to get a date.
That's page 3 for the date.
For the version. It's on the bottom of every page. Yeah.
Okay, the document that I have, it says 8/27/2015. Page 8.
It's Rule 21.
I don't have a Rule 21 on my page 8.
No.
It's on page 10.
Mine's on page 10.
It's on page 10.
At the top of page 10?
Yeah, page 10.
It's on page 10.
Yeah.
Okay.
Is this here? Here we go.
You're on the old one.
This is the same one. Apparently the copy that got printed here and the one that I took off at home came out with different page numbers.
Oh, okay.
At the end of it. But you've got to figure it out.
Okay. You still have the same information, though.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mr. Roth, do you want to?
Yeah, so I can definitely address your question. Mm-hmm. I'll read the section of the charter which you identified here, and that's 1604 conflict of interest. And what it says is an elective officer, appointee, or employee who has a conflict between a personal interest and the public interest as defined by law, this charter or ordinance shall fully disclose to the chief legal officer the nature of the conflict. That's section A. Section B, except as provided by law, no elective officer, appointee, or employee of the city may participate in, vote upon, or act upon any matter if a conflict exists. Mm-hmm. Okay, So essentially what that means is that if you have a personal interest in a matter that's before the commission, you should abstain from that vote. If you look at Rule 21, which you've identified, mm-hmm. the proposed rules for the Charter Commission, I don't think that there's anything in that rule that, that contradicts that charter provision. So okay. The answer to your question is no.
Okay, and 55?
So 55, presumption that all commissioners will vote, sort of reiterates the procedure and process for voting. But the, right, so it's by this rule, it's presumed that a commissioner is going to vote. However, if you do have a conflict, as stated in Rule 21, you abstain from the vote. Okay. And essentially, that's how that procedure works.
Okay. Okay, I just wanted to make sure. Okay. Also, to bring before the commission for question, page 13, Rule 33, order of business. There was a lot of discussion on public comment. And I was to bring to the commission a question on page 14, line item 294, where it says final discussion. What that would be is after the third reading of the proposal on page 13, the public will comment. Then we as a commission will have discussion. And it was, I brought up that perhaps we should hear from the public one last time before we vote, that they be allowed to hear our thoughts on the final reading, this third reading of the proposal, hear our discussion, and they be allowed the opportunity to have a final comment before we vote. There was a lot of discussion about it, and so I'm to bring also that to the commission as to whether or not that should be added in it or not.
Any comments?
If I may make a comment on the
sure.
public comments. Mm-hmm. I do appreciate how in our current agenda we have public comment on agenda items right before we go to committee reports, especially because comments may be not related to a specific reading, but in a general nature regarding a report or other items that are on the agenda. So I would recommend that we, as we have been, have public comment on agenda items in between review of minutes and reports of committees, but also keep the public comment on general items where you have it listed as number 12.
So just to clarify, the suggestion is to have two general public comment periods, one before the main proposal stuff and one after it?
Yeah, the first one would be on agenda items, and the second one would be
on proposals.
As you have it as number 12, general public comment.
And where would you suggest that we put the first general public comment on the agenda?
On agenda items, I would insert that in between numbers 4 and 5, review of minutes and reports of committees, which is how we've been operating currently.
Any other comments or suggestions?
So do we want to tackle the issues that Commissioner McKenzie brought up on a one-by-one basis?
Yes, let's move forward.
Which is the first one you wanted to go through?
I think the first one she read was a committee of the whole.
Yes, of changing the name to work session.
I think everyone was in agreement, although we did not vote on it, but I think everyone was in agreement when we were going after the training. I think everybody agreed to that, so it shouldn't be, no?
So my,
that's what
if Barry wants
I thought we did agreed on it, but some of the committee members didn't remember. So that's why we're bringing it to the body.
So my suggestion is that the meetings themselves be called work sessions, but committee of the whole here is more than just a meeting. It's like a function, right? So I don't see an issue. I don't see those as conflicting issues of having committee in the whole here and having our meetings called work sessions, because committee of the whole here is a process by which we send proposals to the committee of the whole and get voted out of committee of the whole. It's a procedural function, as it were. So that's my take on this. And I think if we do that, we're going to have to do a lot of reworking of the rules themselves, because it specifically states that items are received by committee of the whole. And we probably need to rename. I don't think you could rename it work session, because it's a, we'd have to come up with a different name.
Wasn't that what we learned in the class, that it should be as a work session?
Yes, it was.
Because so I guess I'm kind of confused with John. Are you kind of want to twist it the other way around?
No, I think committee of the whole, as we laid it out, functions as a work session. Okay, the meetings. I mean, because a work session is a meeting. And I think as we laid it out, the committee of the whole meetings act as a work session.
Yeah. We can make a vote on, but my vote is for how they taught us in the classroom on Friday, that Friday. So that's my take.
Would someone like to make a motion?
I'd like to make a motion that we change the name of Committee of the Whole to Work Session, as was taught in the MML study session.
Support.
Question?
Yeah, that doesn't make sense to me. In terms of, so what we would be doing is we would be referring a proposal to a work session, and not to a committee, but to a work session. I don't know what we mean when we say we're referring a proposal to a work session. We're referring something to a body, which we call a committee of a whole, which is a working body. The work that goes on inside that body is a work session activity, but the body is a committee of the whole, and we're sending the proposals is we've set these rules out to a body. And the body is doing work within it. All the work that we do every day at this meeting is a work session, mm-hmm. because we're studying and working on things. We receive information from someone at the podium, which is a way to learn, and it's part of work session. So it doesn't make sense to me to be calling a committee of the whole, which is a body, an entity, an activity. It seems to me that those are two different kinds of things. So I'm in opposition to changing the committee of the whole, because I see that as an entity and not as an activity.
The way that I, Madam Chair, remembered Attorney Matheson's training was that the wording was antiquated. They don't use committee of the whole anymore. That they are work sessions and because they're not a separate group of people, that committee of the whole is the same people, the same commissioners, mm-hmm. that the days that we don't meet as a commission, we meet on those opposite days or as this particular Rule 8 states, when the chairperson calls a meeting for that work session, that we work directly on our proposals. And that's all we do at that meeting. So that when we do come to our commission meetings, the work has already been done. We're bringing those proposals, and the meetings go a lot faster and a lot smoother. And that's why, you know, I object to it being called Committee of the Whole. I cannot see us spending $800 for training, as the Planning Commission has said. They're all trained and they know what they're doing. We spend $800 for training, and we're not going to take up the training that was offered to us and implemented. And that's why I'm against it and would like to have it changed according to our training.
Okay. I don't see this as in conflict in our training at all. We have meetings of the Committee of the Whole, which are work sessions in which we work on stuff. I don't believe that what was communicated to us was that we need to have a different name. I think what was communicated to us is when we confer with the public and we say what we're doing, we tell them that we're having a work session, in that most of our meetings consist of active work sessions.
Okay. Yeah, I guess that's what I understood too, there to be in operation only, that we have a meeting as a work session. I don't know if we needed to change names and rename things to have a work session. I didn't get that, so I'm confused.
Okay, let's call for the vote. Yeah. Would you read the
motion? The motion.
Okay. Welcome.
No.
Yes.
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 No.
Mr. Richardson?
No.
Ms. Wesley?
No.
Yes.
The vote is 4-4.
Oh.
For discussion.
Well, we'll have to vote again.
We haven't adopted our rules yet.
We have a person missing. That's why they're tied.
Right. Right.
Can we move this to next week or next?
As unfinished business.
Yes. We will table it.
We're tabling.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Let's table it. Yes. Okay. What was the next item?
You know, before we move on to the next item, it might, before we take it back up again, I would like to suggest that we actually send this over to the Michigan Municipal League and have their take on it. I think that might help inform our vote.
Is that a proposal? I support it.
I think we can agree to that.
Yeah, I agree to that.
Chair?
Yes, I do, because they did say that before we voted on it, they would like to read it over, and it never was sent to them. So, yes, I do agree.
All right.
With the stipulations that they particularly look at that item.
Okay. We'll do that.
The other item that we wanted to bring to the body to vote on is to add public comment, general public comment on agenda items after number 4, rule 33, and also to add public comment before vote, line item number 294, before the final vote on page 14.
Motion.
Support.
No, we need a. Was that in the form of a motion?
These two separate things or one?
Where they're adding public comment.
I'd like
in
to
two
tackle
different
them
places
separately, if that's all right.
Mm-hmm. It's up to the chair.
Okay, let's do them separately. Okay. Motion on the first one.
Are we flip-flopping them now? I thought it's basically the same thing. It's only just one is above the other, correct? So what difference does it make whether you take one at a time?
I think they're two separate things.
Okay.
Okay, then the first one is adding general public comment on agenda items after number 4, line item 283. Is there a discussion?
I'll second.
Okay. Question?
I would ask that we strike the word general and just say public comment on agenda items so that it's clear, because the second one would be general public comment.
public comment on agenda?
Agenda items.
Items, okay.
Would you state that again where you see general?
Line item 283 on page 13. Number four, where it says review of minutes.
Yes.
We want to add public comment on agenda items.
After the minutes.
After number four.
After number four. But you stated there was one of the words you wanted to change?
I just wanted it to not start with the word general public comment, so that it would read on the agenda, public comment on agenda items.
Okay.
So are you moving to amend the motion that's currently on the table?
Mm-hmm.
This one,
I guess I'm making a motion to amend the motion that's currently on the table.
Okay.
Support.
Okay. Motion, please.
The motion is to add public comment on the agenda, on agenda items, after number four, after line 283.
Mm-hmm. Which would read, how would it read?
Public
how would
comment.
It read? Public comment.
On agenda items.
Okay. All right.
Okay.
Yes.
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 Okay, motion passed. Okay, next item.
On the next page, page 14, after line item 294, add public comment before vote, before final vote.
Motion.
Support.
After line item.
After
yes, ma'am. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, I need clarification. This means that there will only be two public comments, correct?
Right.
Mm-mm.
No.
Okay. Can you clarify your?
Okay.
This means we'll have four public comments.
Four public comments.
Four. Or no, five.
Ah.
Yeah.
I don't need no
Madam
five
Chair?
Public comments.
Yes.
In my comments at the beginning of the discussion on public comments, it was not my intention to request to add an additional public comment, but simply to clarify that number 12 would be public comment on general items. I just want to make sure, in case there was a confusion, I hadn't requested that, and maybe ask for a clarification if that was some additional discussion that took place during the committee meeting to recommend that additional public comment as stated in the motion.
Okay. A clarification. Where would the second comment, public comment, be placed?
Okay, what we're discussing now is after the third reading, line item 292.
Mm-hmm.
When that proposal is read, the public can comment on that particular reading as they have done in the first and second proposals. Then the commissioners will then have a discussion on the proposal. It was brought up at our meeting that after our discussion on that proposal, whether we are for it or against it, that the public should be allowed to have
comment, because they may bring up something here in our discussion that we have not thought of on that proposal, or they may be give us an affirmative or negative on that particular proposal, and then we take a final vote. Because once the public gives comment on the actual reading and not hearing our discussion, they may have some input that we had not thought about. And since we are doing these proposals to meet the needs of the public, I felt it that we should hear from them after we give our reasoning of yay or nay on a particular on that particular proposal, okay, before we give a final vote.
Okay, so the motion is on
to add
292.
294. After 294B, add final comment, public comment before final vote.
Was there a second on that? Okay. Any more questions?
Can we have discussion? Mm-hmm. Okay. So on this, as I understand it, we would have our third reading of a proposal, then the public would comment on that, then we would discuss it, and under this proposal, they would then comment back to us after we had discussed it, and then we would vote. And my perspective on this is I think it invites us getting into arguments and debates with the public, and I think that's going to create a conflict situation that would not be healthy. I certainly understand. So I think we should only have one public comment in the third reading area, and I think it would be most valuable before us having our discussion, so that when we can incorporate the items that the public talks to us about in our own debate before we make our decision.
Any other discussion? Call for the vote.
Yes, ma'am.
After 294B.
Yes, ma'am. Does
that count?
Yes.
No.
Oh, we need a good laugh now. Okay.
I'm sorry. No.
I meant to say this to cancel.
You want to start all over?
I'd like to, yes.
Yes.
Mr. Metcalf?
No.
Ms. Fallon?
No.
Mr. Richardson?
No.
Ms. Weston?
No.
Mr. Williams?
No.
Mr. Cherry?
No.
No.
Seven?
No.
Motion fail. Okay. Is there another area?
That's all.
That's all. Okay. Thank you.
Also, there's not an area for change. Rule 61 on page 21, line item 480, states in all cases not provided by these rules, the authority shall be Robert's Rule of Order as most recently revised. At the beginning of our sessions, the clerk's office, city clerk Inez Brown, stated that she can provide us with the Roberts Rules of Order booklets. We voted at that time not to do it because we didn't need it. If these rules pass, that particular rule states that we will be using those, and it was in part of our training that each of us have a book, And so I'm asking that we be able to give that to the Finance Committee so that they can locate monies to purchase those books. Because if this passes, we're gonna all need a copy.
Correct. But I wasn't aware that we voted not to use the booklet?
At the very beginning, I brought it up and we said no, because we may or may not need it.
Okay. I remember also bringing up that we needed the revised edition. I'm surprised.
Yeah, we voted no.
Okay. All right, but that's something that we can pass on.
I'm asking to submit to the Finance Committee.
Yeah, that's something we can pass on to the Finance Committee.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
She said buy our own books.
Okay. All right, let's move on. It's getting late. Okay.
Madam Chair?
Yes.
A question, please. When would it be appropriate to present the entire document for adoption by this commission?
Well, will this conclude the work that you have to put into it? Do you have to have more meetings
Than a review by the MML?
Well, then I would think the next meeting, our first September meeting, should be ready.
Yeah, I would like to have one meeting after the MLL gives us their recommendations,
mm-hmm.
and then we bring a final document to the commission.
So would that be the second meeting in September?
You mean a meeting of the full commission or your
committee meeting?
The rules, yeah.
Once we receive the document back from the MML, I would like for the Rules Committee to meet to go mm-hmm. over their recommendations, if any, and then we bring a final clean copy draft to this commission.
Okay. Well, if that can be done before the first meeting in September, we can do that.
Yeah.
Just according to how quickly you can get the information
back. It just
back.
Depends on how quickly we can get it back from them.
Okay.
So I'll let you know whenever I hear from them.
All right. Okay, thank you. Public outreach?
Thank you, Madam Chair. There is a copy of the meeting minutes, and I did make a correction. The date's August 19th on the top, so if you're having trouble reading that, that's a 19. So we met on the 19th, and just to kind of, for the sake of time, I'm just going to hit the highlights. We're working on the website. Janelle has been working very hard on it. She's gotten a lot of things done, and there's only a few pieces to put together before we can publish that. And along those same lines, the clerk's office is working with the IT department to get us email that should be coming soon, as well as a phone line. So hopefully we'll have all those items completed in the next 2 weeks. Our Facebook page is up and running. Thank you, John, for making some posts on the meetings, and John has said he'd be willing to put out items on there when we have a meeting posted to share that information. We do have video recordings. Thank you very much, Spectacle Productions. One item that we presented at the last meeting was a contract for services for the video recordings. We tabled making approval on that because of a question on additional fees for live streaming and video upload to YouTube. So we would like to add an additional $200 to the contract. That would be a one-time fee that would be split into four equal payments of $50 for the equipment that Spectacle would need to have in order to do the live streaming. So I'm, I guess at this time, requesting that we formally approve contracting services with Spectacle Productions for video recording of the Charter Commission meetings, and that be retroactive to the meeting on August 13th, where he was recording for us as well. But that basically be the contract that we reviewed last time, plus this $200 one-time fee.
You want to put that in the form of a motion?
Make a motion that we contract with Spectacle Productions for video recording. Do you want me to go into all those details?
Not all the details, but
with the contract that we presented at the last meeting, plus the additional $200.
Okay. Motion's on the floor. Need a support.
Support.
Now we can discuss.
Any question?
Question. Are these monies going to be located from the city, from Ms. Henderson, since they're under a freeze, or do we have monies to pay the video recordings person?
My understanding is we have monies to pay for video recording in small items. It's the big items over $10,000 that are of concern that would require more approval.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
What's the amount? I'm trying to find it.
The contract states that the cost for services.
Got it. $100 per scheduled meeting.
$100 per, yep, scheduled meeting. And if we go over, there's $50 per hour, anything above 2 hours. So we're basically.
10 minutes.
Yeah, into that today, which we had talked about. We knew when we talked about the rules and invited all the folks to come,
right,
this would happen. And then we would add 200 onto that.
Okay. Okay. 200 is one time only.
One time only, split in four
okay.
amounts.
Hit.
Thank you.
All right. Roll call. Go ahead. Yes, go ahead.
Okay, the motion was to formally contract with Spectacle Productions. The contract that was received in the last meeting would add on an additional $200 for lives to be in the vehicle.
Okay.
Mr. Metcalf?
Yes.
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 Okay, motion passed.
Thank you. Moving on to the advisory committee, we will set the first meeting to be October 1st. I have made contact with Nayira Sharif to ask her if she'd be willing to chair the first meeting. I'm awaiting her response. Letters to the council persons, interest form will be created, and a copy of the roles and responsibilities will be on the back of that interest form. The materials will be sent out on and added to our webpage by September 7th, hopefully sooner, but that's definitely, we definitely have it by then. Clerical support. You guys, we've already heard, you know, the report from the Finance Committee. I wanted to get some feedback from everyone here if you felt it would be worthwhile to reach out to the University of Michigan Flint for additional volunteer support, and that maybe, different pieces of work related to public outreach in our meetings. I don't know what that would be, but I really want to just kind of have that conversation. I'd like to have your blessing in order to start those conversations.
I think it's a great idea.
If there's no objections.
Blessing.
All right, blessings given. Okay. Regina Laurie is available for facilitation support for a meeting on September 26th. We plan on sending out invitations to the Charter 1974 Charter Commission members. Those letters will go out by Monday, August 31st, and we would be inviting them to our next committee of the whole meeting, the next time we're all together. And I see that we do have with us tonight from memorandum from David Roth on Article 1, and thank you very much.
Yes, you're very welcome.
So do everybody take some time to review that. Is there anything you wanted to share with us at this time on the?
Yeah, I only wanted to mention was that this should obviously be read in conjunction with the copy of the charter that you've been provided. I think that's where you're going to find it the most helpful. I tried to, as best as I could, put it in plain language, but if you have questions, you can obviously bring them to me. What I did want to note was that, in particular, this first article, a lot of the provisions are relatively self-explanatory. Many of them have to do with just basic statutory construction, such as like the preamble, the name of the city remains the city of Flint. So, but if you do have questions, feel free to email me. And if there's anything in particular that you think would be necessary for a phone call, I'm always available in the office.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
I see the notes here. I was going to make a motion, a reminder to make a motion to send letters to the 74 charter commissioners to come speak to the commission.
Support.
That was, well, it's decided some time ago, but we can, I don't think we have to vote.
Voice vote?
Yes, it was decided some time ago.
Okay. Oh, okay.
Mm-hmm. All right, great.
Well, then I'll withdraw the motion.
Okay. So the next thing we'll be doing is spending a lot of time focusing on the kickoff meeting. We did present a budget for expenses, which I have detailed out here. These are general estimates. I know facilitation is definitely 1,000. We, you know, depending on the length and time of the video, it's probably going to be 150, 2-hour meeting. So this is like a general number to get us going. Once we refine the food, for instance, then that can be tightened up some. But at this time, I'm requesting approval for this budget of expenses of $2,220 for the kickoff meeting on September 26th.
So moved.
Question? Oh, I'm sorry.
Oh, support. So I can support that then. Thank you, John.
Go ahead. I'm so cold, I'm shaking.
Can you do this by voice vote?
Yes.
Can we just do it by voice vote?
Yes. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Any opposed? All right. Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, that's one reason, because the clerk can't tell.
The flyer will be developed and go out September 1st. It needs to get out pretty soon. We have a timeline here, and after our meeting with the Michigan Municipal League, you know, they really encouraged us to reevaluate that timeline. And so I want to just put this out here, review it, take a look at it. Basically, what I've done is lengthened it out quite a bit. Each month where we were talking about Article 1, now it's saying Article 1 is 2 months long, Article 2 is 2 months long. And adding in additional 4 months for state review, and then 3 more months for outreach, with an August 2017 potential special election. You know, and so this is very fluid. This is just trying to take the thoughts of MML and their suggestions to us and put back something that might be more practical than November 2016. Last thing we talked about was our meeting dates. Please note they have changed. They're going to be on the first and third Mondays of the month. We also changed the time to 6 p.m., really to help give me more time to, you know, get there from work. And this was also to be able to incorporate more folks from other committees who have not yet, you know, have not been formally assigned to public outreach, but really, Jim Richardson, we hope that you can join us at some of these meetings, and also to accommodate Commissioner McKenzie, because we really appreciate having her involved in the discussions as well. So that was the last item, and then that's the report.
Thank you.
Oh, I did skip over one thing. I would like to know if everyone is comfortable with and this is at your discretion. How do you feel about having your personal phone number on your business card? Would you prefer to just have a number at the clerk's office, or when you have a business card, would you like it to have the number to the clerk's office as well as your personal number? And so I felt like that was something each person should kind of think about individually. And if, for the sake of time, if you'd like me to just email the group and you can respond how you would like to.
Because we have two.
It's okay
right
with
now.
Me. It's okay with me.
Everybody's pretty comfortable with that?
No.
No, you're not?
No.
Leave just the city?
Yes.
Okay. Great.
Send an email out.
I'll send an email out and you can all respond.
Do we have all of the pictures now?
We have to follow up with that. Okay. Should, but they may not have been delivered yet to the clerk's office.
I talked with the lady from Van Dyke today. She said that Ms. Brown has all the pictures.
Okay, great.
Okay,
excellent.
I have a question on the timeline, please.
Yes.
It's not the timeline, it's an addition. Is there a reason that the ombudsman's office will not be discussed?
Will not be discussed?
It's not listed.
It's in one of those articles.
Civil service is listed, but not the ombudsman's office.
Oh,
we can always add it.
We can add it in.
Could you please?
It's nothing concrete.
Absolutely.
Yeah, that's what I'm asking.
It was not meant to be omitted, certainly.
Oh, okay. All right. Is that it?
We also request that we keep it a little bit warmer in here. The committee would like to.
I don't know what we can do about that.
Okay. No, that was it.
Well, let's quickly move on to our old business, potential presentations. Commissioner, do you have anything from Pontiac?
No, ma'am.
Okay. I do want to let you know that the new assistant to Ms. Henderson worked on the public relations portion of the charter for Pontiac. So we do want to sit down with him and have a conversation regarding that his work on that commission. And Heidi has already mentioned about the 1974 Charter Review Commission members attending. And the only reason the Michigan Municipal League is still on here is that we went through the training, and I felt the training was great. I'm very appreciative. And anybody else have any comments regarding the training? Okay, the rules of procedure, Commissioner, is anything else besides the items that you have already submitted?
Nothing else.
Okay. Is there any other additional business to be brought before the commission?
Yeah, so previously I had talked about getting assistance from the Ford School. So I had reached the Ford School of Public Policy at the University of Michigan in Ann Arbor. And I had reached out to them, and I got contacted literally this afternoon, and set up a conference or set up a call tomorrow. So I wanted to gauge from commissioners on what kind of consulting expertise we would be looking for, like on what type of basis, whether it's public outreach or whether it's formal consulting on charter stuff, to inform that conversation.
Now,
and these services would be ones we don't pay for.
This would be for the administrative assistant?
No.
No?
This is consulting assistance from the public, the
okay.
Academic.
From the grad students at the Ford School.
All right, okay. We've also received a communication from Mr. Matheson with about four names that may be interested, and then I received another one from Ms. Brown's office that had made contact with her office. So we'll take a look at all of those. But you need to know something because you're going to talk to them tomorrow.
What kind of consulting expertise we might be looking for?
Well, one of the things we had said was that we needed someone who could help us not a daily basis, but help us as we're moving through the step by step on things that we would need research on and so forth. Anybody else have any other suggestions?
Yeah, John, kind of assistance that I would like us to be able to have is is, I guess, some research into different options on various issues that we may engage that are what you might call elephants in the room. I think is what we talked about. You know, forms of government, ways in which councils function. And identification of other issues that maybe we ought to look at. I'd love to learn more about best practices.
That's right.
And successes or what's worked and what hasn't worked, where and why, would be very helpful. I'm looking for information, and I'm flying blind here, and I certainly would like to turn some lights on so I kind of see where we're going.
Do you think that being as they're grad students, that maybe like a literature review, some like level of literature review on some of the practices, like what's being talked about? Is there any articles in the field of charter development that they can pull from? I don't know if there's a journal of charter review commissions.
There we go. Journal of charter.
Journal of charters.
Okay. Before we adjourn, I do want to go back to the public comment. Is there anyone who would like to address the commission this evening from the public? Is there anyone?
And so if I receive a proposal from them, where should I send that? To go to Marcia's committee or go to...
you can...
Or to you?
Yeah. And then we'll get with finance and see what...
Okay.
Because there are others as well that we need to look at.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Now everyone has, we have all of the meeting dates for commission meeting as well as for committee meetings, right? You have all of that, so you won't need to, okay?
Just to clarify, our next meeting is a committee of the whole, or is that a... Is our next meeting going to be in the small room?
We won't know yet. That's under request. So I'm hopeful that it will.
Okay.
Because according to the schedules, we're okay, except for when the council has special meetings. Mm-hmm. So, and if they have a special meeting, then we can be thrown someplace else. Anything else? Motion to adjourn?
Move that the meeting be adjourned.
Support? I guess people don't want to leave.
Support.
Support.
All in favor?
Aye.
Me. Us.
Oh, great.
Did you get the...